It's a joy to be with you again. Looks like they want me to be here every week. God bless every one of you. We're going to pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your children, for your servants, for every one of us. I will thank you, Lord, because the joy of the Lord will be our strength in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, your hand will be upon every life. Every need you'll supply. And everything we do for your glory, you'll bless in Jesus' name. Lead us into the truth. Lead us by the truth. And Lord, we pray that this truth and this word will work mightily in every life. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you. We can sit down. Tonight we're looking at Matthew chapter 25. And I'm going to select some verses there to read. Matthew chapter 25, I'm reading from verse 14. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling unto a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, and to another 2, and to another 1, and to every man according to his several ability. And straightway he took his journey. We're looking at what Christ said about workers, and we are workers here tonight. Any worker there? You will do the work. Many people do not understand. They just said work or worker. But let me explain it in this simple way. A driver drives. If he doesn't drive, whatever certificate, whatever title, whatever place of work, that's not a driver. A farmer farms. Whatever his education and whatever he may claim to be, if he does not farm, that's not a farmer. A swimmer swims. If he is not swimming, and I ask him, he has not been swimming for the past 2 or 3 years, and then he claims the title swimmer. I said, no, that's not a swimmer. And then a learner learns. You find somebody that never learns anything, and he says, I'm a learner. I say, no. It is what you do with what you hear that makes you actually a learner. A helper helps. If you're not helping anything, anyone, anytime, don't call yourself a helper. And then a teacher teaches. If you're going to be called a teacher, you will take those first 5 letters of the word teacher, you teach. And then a worker, tell me out loud, a worker works. And so we need to understand, when you say you are a worker, before you use that word, I'm a worker, you want to find out, do you really work? Let's look at Mark chapter 13. Mark chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 34. For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, very similar to the one I read to you in Matthew, who left his house and gave authority to his servants, listen to this, and to every man, tell me, his work. And to every man, his work. He's giving you something to do. And you need to understand, wherever you are working, wherever the area of activity, and you can define it yourself, describe it yourself, and you can tell yourself, this is the area of my work. And for you to be a worker, you must see what the Lord has committed to your hand, that particular thing, and ask yourself, am I working? Am I a worker? And it says in that verse 34, that he committed, he gave every man his work, and then commanded the porter to watch. Because he has given the work, he's coming back, and he's going to evaluate what we're doing. We're coming back to Matthew chapter 25. In Matthew chapter 25, I now read from verse 20. He came back now, And after he came back, he'll be asking what each one has done concerning the talent, concerning the work that he gave each one. And in Matthew chapter 25, reading from verse 20, so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliveredst unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained besides them 5 talents more. You see, if you're going to give 5 talents at the end of the day of reckoning, it is at this time now you're giving 5. From today, you will plan and you will project, and then you'll prepare yourself, and then you address yourself to the work. You say, I'm going to gain 5 more. I'm going to make 100% gain. And that's what gain, I'm going to make profit. That is, this is what he committed to my hand, 5 talents. And then at the end, on the day of reckoning, I'm going to gain 5 more. You plan today, you project today. And then you address yourself to the work, and you prepare yourself, and you feel every moment of the work, because you have your goal. Look at verse 22. He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliveredst unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them. Again, that's 100%. He had 2, and then he planned, he projected, and he prepared himself. He addressed himself to the work, and he said, here is it. I have gained 2 more. Make it practical. You're a health fellowship leader, and you started with 7. At the end of the day, on the day of reckoning, can you say you gained 7 more? Here you are a pastor, and you have a congregation of about 80 that you started with. When the time of reckoning comes, would you be able to say, I gained 80 more? Or whatever work you're doing, or whatever area of work the Lord has committed to your hand, would you be able to say, I got 5 at the beginning, I gained 5 more profit? I got 2 at the beginning, I got 2 more profit. And now we'll look at verse 24. Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee, that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou wast not sown, and gathering where thou wast not strawed. And I was afraid, and went and had thy talent in the earth. He thy talent in the earth, lo, there thou hast that is thine. The one that had 5 gained 5 more. The one that had 2 gained 2 more. The one that had 1 gained, tell me, 0. They used to put that 0 as a big O, and then they put dot inside it. Did you see that before? On the final day, the Almighty God will take that paper from some people's hand and put a big O there and put a dot inside and said, a 0 man, a 0 woman, no gain, no profit. Look at what happened to him. Verse 30. And cast she, the unprofitable servant, into outer darkness, and there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Well, the day of reckoning has not come. That's the reason why we need to reason together today, so that days, when that day comes, you will not be unprofitable. You will not be a 0 man, a 0 woman. You will be a profitable servant, a profitable worker, a profitable child of God. We're looking at this message tonight, the choice of profitable or unprofitable lives. It's a choice. It's a choice. The one that had 5 talents and gained 5 more, that was his choice. The one that had 2 and gained 2 more, that was his choice. And the one that had 1 and gained nothing and did nothing, and worked at nothing, and received nothing, and only got condemnation, that was his choice. I will be profitable. the choice of profitable or unprofitable servants. You see, it is possible for you to plan and for you to look ahead. There are many people that live their lives, they never think of the reckoning day. They never seek of the accounting day. They never seek of the final day. They never seek of the day when the Lord will call them and say, I give you 5 talents. What have you done with that? I give you ability. What have you done with that? I give you opportunity. What have you done with that? I give you responsibility in the household of faith. What have you done with that? You called, you were called a worker. What have you done in the work? You were called a preacher. How did you preach? You were called a soul winner. How did you win souls? And you were called a leader. How did you lead? Because a leader must lead. A teacher must teach. A worker must work. A driver must drive. If you are going to be a worker, there must be something you are doing that everybody will know. That's a driver there, he drives. That's a worker there, he walks. That's a farmer there, he farms. That's a learner there, he learns. That's a teacher there, he teaches. You will do something. And when you do it to profit. Let's read this verse 30 again. This verse 30, it says, cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. Number one, the descriptive figures of unprofitable servants. How do you describe somebody who is unprofitable? Descriptive figures of unprofitable servants. Number two, the destined future for unprofitable servants. It's good for us to know, if you're traveling on the road that has no profit, you should know the end of that road. If you're traveling on a road that has no gain, you should know the end of that road. If you're traveling on a road that unprofitable servants travel, the people you find there are only unprofitable people, you should know the destination, the destiny, the place where you're going. And so you have the destined future for unprofitable servants. Number three, divine favor. This is where I am. I said, this is where I am. Divine favor for profitable servants. I will be profitable. I thought you'll say that aloud. You will be profitable in Jesus' name. Divine favor for profitable servants. Let's come to number one, the descriptive figures of unprofitable servants. Think about this now. Look at this servant that came to the Lord on the final day and said, here you have your own. Only 1 talent, the 1 talent you gave me. I know you are a hard master. I know you're trying to gather where you have not strawed or, you know, farmed or done anything. And so I hid it for you, and now it's waiting for you. And the Lord said, unprofitable, unprofitable. That figure, the unprofitable servant, what words actually describe them? Why are they unprofitable? Number one, unmindful of God's grace. Unmindful of God's grace. The Lord gave them grace, and the Lord gave them opportunity and showed them mercy. They were unmindful about the grace of God. Number two, unfaithful to God's goodness. God was good to them. And he gave them what did not merit. And gave them these talents. And he said, work until I come. Occupy until I come. You have been saved. I showed my mercy. I revealed the gospel unto you. Go and tell other people. Unfaithful to God's goodness. Number three, unbelieving in God's government. Unbelieving in God's government. You see, the government of God, the government of God employs people. The government of God, just like the government of the world. And it will say, you do this, you do this, you do this. At the end of the day, on the reckoning day, I'll give you your reward. And he got these people, and he got you, and he got me. And he says, you are now in my government. I'm giving you this work to do, and that assignment to do. But you see, these unprofitable people, they are unbelieving in God's government. Number four, unthankful for God's gift. Unthankful for God's gift. We didn't merit that. Think about yourself. You didn't merit the gift of God. You didn't merit all the offering, everything the Lord has given you. And yet, he gave you this, he gave you this, he gave you that. And when you think about it, other people could have got the same gift. But he gave it to you in particular. And he said, occupy until I come. and you are so unthankful for God's gift. Number five, uncircumcised for godliness. You see, their hearts are still depraved. That's why that unprofitable servant was accusing God. I know you are a hard man. That man's heart was uncircumcised. His mind was uncircumcised. His nature was uncircumcised. A person that is circumcised, circumcised in heart, circumcised in ear, is not going to accuse the Lord that the Lord is a hard man. Number six, unstable in his goings. Unsteady, unstable in his going. He goes here, there's nothing he can find there to do. He goes to another place, there's nothing he can find to do. You put him in house fellowship work, he can do nothing. You say, okay, maybe he doesn't fit there. You put him into another area, and yet he still cannot do anything. This is the unstable one in his goings. Number seven, unwise in this generation. The generation is winding up to a close. At the time of reckoning, it's about to come. And the man remains foolish. It's like one of the foolish virgins. The lamp is going out, and the Lord is about to come. The bridegroom is about to come, and the angels are about to sound the trumpet. Buck up and hurry up, because the end is coming. The one is unwise in this generation. Number eight is unfruitful in the gospel. Unfruitful in the gospel. Let's look at this one by one. Number one here, he is what? Unmindful of God's grace. We're looking at Deuteronomy chapter 32. Deuteronomy chapter 32. And I'm reading here from verse 18. Deuteronomy chapter 32. And we're looking at verse 8. And you will see how the Bible describes these people. The figures that are used for unprofitable people, unprofitable workers, the people that they do not contribute anything. The Lord has given them a life to live, no contribution. The Lord gives them a seat to sit on, no contribution. The Lord gives them a title, no contribution. The Lord gives them an assignment to do, there's no contribution. They are unmindful of the grace of God. 32 verse 8. 32, we're looking at verse 8. It says in verse chapter 32, I'm reading here from verse 8, I'm trying to open it. It says, when the Most High divided, when the Most High, I'll read this verse, but I'll search for the verse I'm looking for. It says, when the Most High divided the nations to their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. And when he said the number according to the children of Israel, he said, this is your boundary, this is your area, and this is where you ought to be. But then it says, these people were foolish, and they did not consider the things of the Lord, and they were unmindful of the grace of God and of the privilege that he gave them. And it's because they are unmindful. They knew the Lord will come. They knew that he will take inventory. They knew that at then on the final day, he was going to challenge them and ask them, what have you done with the things I gave you to do? But they were unmindful of the coming of the Lord. They were unmindful of what the Lord himself will ask them eventually. I pray you'll not be like that in Jesus' name. You will mind what the Lord has given to you. You will mind the activity that he expects you to take, and you'll mind everything he wants you to partake of. Number two is that they were unfaithful to God's goodness. Unfaithful to God's goodness. We're looking at Psalm 25. In Psalm 25, I'm reading here from verse 19. Psalm 25, verse 19. As we look at Psalm 25, verse 19, it says, confidence in an unfaithful man in time of trouble is like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint. If you've had any kind of tooth pain before, you understand. Toothache, you'll understand what he's talking about. When God has confidence in you, and then he gives you a talent, he could have given it to another man. could have given that to another woman, could have given that to another brother, could have given that to another sister. But no, he said, I'm going to give this to you. I appreciate you. I love you. I raised you up. I put you in this position at this time so that you will be my mouthpiece and you will be the one that will do the work that I've given you to do. But unmindful and then unfruitful and unfaithful, I pray you'll be faithful. Let's come back to Deuteronomy chapter 32. Deuteronomy chapter 32. We're looking at verse 18. Deuteronomy chapter 32 verse 18. Of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful. Thou art unmindful. That's why they're unproductive. That's why they're unprofitable. That's why there's no gain. The Lord has given them talent. They just kept the talent there. They do not remember the Lord. They are unmindful of God's grace. They are unfaithful to God's goodness. They are unbelieving in God's government. You know, it says, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. And then it says, the government shall be upon his shoulder. When Jesus came, he came as king. The king of the Jews and the king of Israel and the king of his people is the king of kings and the Lord of lords. And the king has a kingdom. And the governor has a government. And because he's ruler, he has a government. And in his government, he appoints people. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and pastors and teachers for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, until we all come in the unity of the faith, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. He has given us a work to do. Because when his government, and he expects that we will believe him, the king is coming again, the governor is coming again, and he will reckon with everyone what we have done with whatever he has given us. Revelation chapter 21. In Revelation chapter 21, reading here from verse 8, it says, and the fearful and the unbelieving. The fearful and the unbelieving. You remember what that unprofitable servant said? He said, I was afraid. I was afraid. Because I was afraid, I know you are coming. And I know you are going to ask me, what did I do with that talent? What did I do with that preaching? What did I do with that teaching? What did I do with that leadership? What did I do with the work you gave me to do? And because I was afraid, actually unbelieving, I hid that talent. You know, there are people that, they are appointed as workers in the church and as leaders in the church. They will not do the work and they will not vacate the seat for another person to say, I don't have time, I can't do this, I know I'm just going to find a place. And while I am there, another person cannot be there. They will not vacate that seat and they will not do the work and they hinder other people that could do the work and they're not doing the work. They're unbelieving in God's government. Today, a change will come. A transformation will come. So that you'll not be a person that doesn't mind what God will say, what God will do, and you'll not be a person that will not believe in God's government. Number four is that they are unthankful. Unthankful. Unthankful for God's gift. We're looking at 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 2. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we're reading here from verse 2. It says, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. Oh, stop a moment there. Why are people unprofitable? Lovers of their own selves. They sleep too much. Lovers of their own selves. They care for their own kind of convenience and comfort too much. Lovers of their own self. They spend all their time on themselves. Lovers of their own selves. They spend all their intelligence, everything they've got, all their talents on their own, on themselves. Lovers of their own selves. They have got this certificate. They want another certificate. Lovers of their own selves. I'm working hard time, I'm working part time, I'm working full time, I'm working extra so I can have more money. Workers, these are lovers of their own selves. They abandon the work of the Lord. They abandon the talent. They abandon everything the Lord has given them to do. And they're lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers. And then it says they're disobedient to parents. Tell me the last thing there. unthankful, unholy, unthankful, unholy. What the Lord has done for them, other people came to them so they could be saved. Now they are saved, but they are selfish. They are unthankful. They didn't praise the Lord. So and so came to me, and now I'm saved. If he didn't come to me, how would I be saved? If I don't go to other people, how will they be saved? I'm so thankful to God because he gave me this understanding and he gave me this knowledge. Somebody taught me. I'm grateful. If I'm grateful, I'll teach another person. Somebody followed up on me when I became born again. If I am thankful, I'm going to follow up other people. Somebody told me a good program is going on there, and I went, and lo and behold, my problems are solved. If I am thankful, I'm going to do that to other people. I'm going to tell them something good is taking place. I want to be a partaker of that. But these people, unprofitable people, they are unthankful for God's gift. They are uncircumcised in heart. Their hardness of heart is still there. And they see people dying, their heart in their heart. And they see people perishing, hardness of heart. They don't have any feeling at all for people that die in their sin. They don't have any feeling at all for the people that are suffering. The water of life is there. People are thirsty. They will not even take the effort and bend down and bring that cup of cold water and give to the one that is thirsty. They will not do anything to help the people that need help. And the help is so near, and they can do it. And they know the scripture, and they know the word of God, and they know the gospel. They know that God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And they allow people to perish. Every day they meet people, every day they encounter people. They will never tell them this is the way to life. Are those not people hardened in their hearts? Are they not depraved in their hearts? They don't have any compassion for anybody. That's why it says, look at this in Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. I'm reading from verse 51. Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. And we're looking at verse 51. It says in verse 51, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. Uncircumcised in heart and ears. If my ears are circumcised when I hear the truth, will it not affect me? If my ears are circumcised when I hear that sinners are perishing, and I can rise up and go and tell them they don't have to perish, when I sing, rescue the perishing and care for the dying. If I sing that, if I hear that, will I not reach out to them? If my ears are circumcised, but these ones, their hearts are uncircumcised and their ears are uncircumcised. Uncircumcised for godliness. Number 6, unstable in his goings. Unstable in his goings. Have you found people, when you have said this, workers meetings and everything going on, then they rise up, they say, I'm going to work. And then they joined maybe the choir. And then after we were, read some notes and studied some things, a few weeks, then they leave the choir. And they say, no, I don't think that's my place. Then they go to the ushers. And then when we stand like that for 1 hour, so this is how the work of the ushers. We have to stand like this. I don't think I can bear this one. I think I will go to another area. They're asking for people that will teach the children. And then they go to the children's section. After they spend some time in the children's section, the noise is too much. These children, they can't calm down. They can't sit down. And then you talk to them like this. This one is preaching me. That one is preaching me. Then they leave that place and they say, I think I will go to the people that, morning cry, and I'm going to wake up and I'm going to say, hear the word of the Lord. The Lord is coming. You must give your life to the Lord now. And then, if they team together, and then they wake up at 5 o'clock and they are up and down, and then the following day, you call them, it's time now. I said, the one I did yesterday, I'm telling you, I lost sleep yesterday, and during the day I wasn't myself. I couldn't balance because of they are unstable. You cannot depend on them and say this is where they are. That's why they're unprofitable. A person that plants something now, uproots it, goes to plant it another place, uproots it, going to plant it another place, uproots it, that fellow will never make any gain. Will be unprofitable. I will be profitable. The people that are to be profitable, you see them, you find them at their posts. No matter what, the rain may come, the sun may shine, the heat may come, you find them at their post. But the people who are unstable, they don't make any gain, they don't profit anybody, and they don't profit anything. We're looking at James. Well, James chapter 1, I'm reading here from verse 8. It says, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Unstable, unstable. You cannot depend upon them. You cannot trust them. You can't say, I know brother so-and-so, he'll be there. Go and check him up. You get there, you can't find him. Sister so-and-so will be there. Go and check up. You won't find her because they are unstable. And then number 7, unwise in this generation. Unwise in this generation. We're living in a generation of opportunities. A generation when the Lord sees a lot of challenges and has given us the work to do. And he has said in the bus, you know, opportunity is there. At the train station, opportunity is there. In your place of work, opportunity is there. In your school where you're teaching, opportunity is there. In the market where you're selling, opportunity is there. This is a generation of opportunities. Through the phone, opportunity is there. Through email, opportunity is there. Through sending texts on the phone, opportunity is there. And through all this, satellite sending message, opportunity is there. Through Skype, opportunity is there. Opportunities everywhere to say something for Christ and to tell people they can be saved. But all those opportunities, these people are wise in their generation. I will be wise. We're looking at Hosea chapter 13. Hosea chapter 13. I'm reading from verse 13. Hosea chapter 13. And we're reading from verse 13. The sorrows of a travailing woman shall come upon him. He is an unwise son. He is an unwise son. His father has this business and he wants all his sons to be involved. He wants all the daughters to be involved. But that's an unwise son. That's an unwise daughter. And they're not going to get involved. It's an unwise son. For he should not stay long in the place of the breaking force of children. That is where calamity is taking place and your people are losing their lives. It's so unwise. It stays there. When he can get out of that place and go walk in my vineyard today, you will walk in Jesus' name. Well, eventually it's unfruitful in the gospel. Unfruitful in the gospel. We're looking at Mark chapter 4, verse 19. Mark chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 19. Mark chapter 4, we read from verse 19. This unprofitable servant, here is where we'll find him eventually, in Mark chapter 4, verse 19. It says in verse 19, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust for of other things, entering in, choke the word, and becometh unfruitful. Becometh unfruitful. Becometh unfruitful. That is, he wasn't made to be unfruitful. He wasn't created to be unfruitful. He wasn't called into the kingdom to be unfruitful. He wasn't appointed to be unfruitful, but he became unfruitful. Why? Because desires for other things. Desires for other things. He's looking for sensational things. He's looking for some exciting things. He's looking for popular things. But he cannot address himself to the work and say, I'll do it in the morning, I'll do it in the afternoon, I'll do it at night, I will just give myself there, I will stay at my post and die at my post. But no, a desires for other things, entering in, you know, he is in the choir, and then he says, this one is not exciting enough, he's in the house fellowship, that's not exciting enough, he's soul winners team, that's not exciting enough, he's a teacher of the word of God, that's not exciting enough, I want recognition, I want this, because of that, desires for other things and training will choke the word he heard, will choke all the decisions he made. He took a decision last Saturday or last Tuesday, I will work for God, I will serve the Lord. During the week, desires for other things will come in, and then he becomes unfruitful and unprofitable. But you will be profitable. The figures of the unprofitable servant is unmindful of God's grace, is unfaithful to God's goodness, is unbelieving in God's government, is unthankful for God's gift, is uncircumcised for godliness, is unstable in his goings, is unwise in this generation, is unfruitful in the gospel. What's the end of such people? Look, come back now to Matthew chapter 25, and I'm reading here from verse 30. Matthew chapter 25, and we're reading from verse 30. Here is the word of the Lord himself. He said, cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Cast out the unprofitable servant. I pray this will not be your Lord. But you see, if this is not going to be our Lord, we have to stop right now. And we have to look ahead. A reckoning day is coming. A time when the Lord will take records as to what did you do with what I gave you to do. What did you do with the assignment I gave you? The responsibility I gave you. We say we're workers in a church like this, Deep and Live Bible Church. And the people outside, they're looking up to us and they appreciate us. They even envy us. They say, that person, if I join Deep and Live now, it will take me a long time before they would accept you to be a worker, and they're looking at us as profitable people, as great men and great women, and they say we have special privilege, and we do, and yet we are not thinking of it the way they are thinking of it. We are not looking at ourselves the way they are looking at us. And eventually somebody becomes, but not me, somebody becomes unprofitable. I said somebody, but not me. I said somebody, but not me. Are you hiding your face? Let me see your face now. I said somebody, but not me. Somebody became unprofitable. I will be profitable. Somebody there, I will be profitable. You know, I do something. We learn to do by doing. I do something today, it's difficult. I repeat it tomorrow, it's less difficult. I do it another time, it becomes easy. I do it another time, it becomes enjoyable. I do it another time, it becomes exciting. The first time you try to do it, if you've not been doing it before, it will be tough and difficult. Keep at it. It will become easy. It will become exciting. It will become enjoyable. And God is going to reward you in Jesus' name. You know, the first time you want to talk to somebody, a stranger, and then you know the gospel, the word is in your heart. Bring it out. And then you feel a little bit uncomfortable. Say it all the same, that Jesus Christ is the only Savior. And is the Savior of the world. And whosoever believeth in him will not perish but have everlasting life. When you start, you might stammer, go on. When you start, you might be kind of retarded, go on. When you start, it might be that the word is coming back to you, and you, am I effective? Just go on. Eventually you will swim. Eventually you will flow, and the word in your mouth will bring many people to the kingdom in Jesus' name. But the people that I'm afraid I cannot start, I'm timid, I cannot make any attempt, I'm retarded, I cannot approach any people, I'm not educated, I cannot talk to anyone, and they might reject me and I fear rejection. The people that never do anything, today you do nothing, tomorrow you do nothing, next month you do nothing, this year you do nothing, for the rest of your life you do nothing, I don't envy you. I don't envy your future. Because on the final day, it's going to be terrible. I leave you alone. I face that direction. I say, I will walk. Somebody there said, I will walk. And the Lord will bless the work in your hand in Jesus' name. And let's look at these people unprofitable. We're looking at Matthew chapter 25, verse 30. And it says, cast ye out the unprofitable servant into outer darkness, and there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Can I tell you what will happen to them? Number one, there'll be a casting away. The Lord will just cast them away, unprofitable. Their souls did nothing. Their lives achieved nothing. and their talents amounted to nothing. Their presence in the church did nothing, and their participation among the workers achieved nothing. Number one, they'll be cast away. Number two, they'll be caught asunder. Caught asunder. Look at this in Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 51. It says, "And shall cut him asunder, and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth." They'll be cut asunder. Number three, they'll be condemned. They'll be condemmed. They'll be condemned. That's what Jesus said there in this parable. He said, "You know that I'm a hard master, and you know that I reap where I didn't sow. Why didn't you give the talent to somebody else who will be able to work with it and then have some interest, have some usury?" They will be condemned. And then they'll be cursed. They'll be cursed. Think about that. They'll be cursed. You look at chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25. I'm reading from verse 41. "Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels." Prepared for the devil and his angels. They'll be cursed. And then they'll be crying. They'll be crying. Because that's what Jesus said in that verse 30. It says they'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. There'll be the cry of pain. A cry of pain. There'll be the cry of agony. Agony. "I am tormented in this flame." There'll be the gnashing of teeth. There'll be wailing. There'll be weeping. And then when you think about that, all these people, unprofitable people, unprofitable souls, they couldn't even profit themselves. They couldn't profit themselves and even grow in grace. Even if they are not profiting other people, of course you understand, those who are selfish, a person who is too lazy to go and cook, he'll not cook for himself, not cook for any other person. A person who is so lazy to do anything, he will not help himself, he'll not help other people. That's why they will have sorrow. They'll have suffering. They'll be thirsty on the other side. I pray this will not be your picture. There'll be no comfort for them. You see, those who go to that other side, outside, outer darkness, it says there'll be no comfort for them. Number two, there'll be no care for them. Who is going to care for anybody? Satan is there in hell. The evil angels and his demons are there. And all these people are there. And everybody is suffering. Who will care for another? And even when anybody will say, "Father Abraham, send Lazarus to come and cool my tongue in this place," Abraham will say, "That's not possible. Nobody can cross from here and cross to the other side." No comfort and no care. No cooling water. Can you think of not drinking water for one day? You are not inside fire. You are not inside the heat. But can you think of not drinking water? When the people go to that outer darkness, when you go to the place of weeping and wailing, there will be no water to cool their tongue. There will be no companionship. Can you stay 1 week without any companion? No friend, no talking with anybody, and no sharing with anybody. You're all alone by yourself. Can you spend 1 month not talking to anybody and nobody talking to you? Everybody minds his own business. Everybody is taking care of their pain. Everybody is taking care of their problem. Everybody is suffering. Everybody is crying. And you can't help them. They can't help you. There is no companionship. Then there is no communication. No communication. They can't talk to you. You can't talk to them. Satan is suffering on his own. The demons are suffering on their own. And the sinners are suffering on their own. There is no companionship. There is no compassion. There's no compassion. You cannot say, "Can you have mercy on me there?" Because the day of mercy is gone. Today there is mercy. And today there is grace. You can ask for, compassion today. You can ask for, anything from God today. And God will give it to you. But that time, there will be no compassion, and then there'll be no conclusion. There'll be no conclusion. You see, if somebody is suffering and he knows that my suffering will end tomorrow, everything will be concluded tomorrow. I will suffer like this. I will try to endure. There's no tomorrow. It's not going to end. 1 week is gone. 1 year is gone. 10 years are gone. 100 years are gone. 10,000 years are gone. 1,000,000 years are gone. And it's forever and forever and forever. And there's this eternal forever condemnation and confinement. And thank God I will not be there. I said, thank God I will not be there. For you, Calvary has paid the whole sin. Christ has paid the whole price at Calvary. You can be saved. You can be born again. And you can be sanctified. And you can be on your way to heaven. And then while you are going, think about that yourself. So come along with me. I'm going to that place where Christ has prepared for me. We're going on a journey. Come along. And just by saying, come along, come along, come along, you are bringing other people into the kingdom. You are encouraging other people. Why don't you, you've been in the church for such a long time. Why don't you join us? This work is exciting. This work is rewardable. Come on, let us go and do it together. And while you bring somebody and God is writing a record concerning you, he's saying you're a profitable servant. You're a profitable soul winner. You're a profitable singer. You're a profitable house fellowship leader. You're a profitable teacher there. You're a profitable leader there. Am I talking to somebody? Profitable. You'll be profitable in Jesus' name. And you will not experience the damnation of the people that are profitable in Jesus' name. Let me come to the last point. This is where I am going to be. I said this is where I am going to be. Point number three, divine favor for profitable servants. Profitable servants. Are they here tonight? You'll be profitable. And this work of the Lord will prosper in your hand in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 45. Matthew chapter 24 and verse 45. Who then is a faithful and wise servant whom his Lord has made ruler over his household to give them meat in due season? To give them meat in due season. To give them meat in due season. Look up here for a moment. You know, if your wife is always complaining, you know, daddy or whatever she calls you, I have little headache, I cannot cook today. Okay, you manage. And then the following day, you know, daddy, you know, get into that place and the heat, I don't know what's happening to me. I cannot bear the heat of the kitchen. So is this going to be a permanent thing? We always have an excuse why I cannot cook. We always have an excuse why I cannot set the table. We always have an excuse why we cannot do something for the husband. And we who say we're children of God, always an excuse. I cannot teach today because, you know, of this challenge. I cannot preach today because of this situation. I cannot evangelize today because of this. You will not be like that. All excuses must be cancelled. You're looking at the final day. And you're looking at the day of reckoning. When the Lord will say, I gave you this talent. I gave you this opportunity. Are you telling me that because of this minor problem, you are that minor problem, you went to work now. You had that minor problem, you went to school. You had that minor problem, you went to take an exam. You had that minor problem, and you went to do other things, secular things. And when it comes to my work, the one I committed to your hand, and the one that will have eternal value, is then excuses come. From today, all excuses are cancelled. I am not an excuse maker. I said I'm not an excuse maker. Because it says over here, to give them meat in due season, blessed is that servant. Somebody there is blessed today. Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily, I say unto you that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. He will bless you in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm reading here from verse 8. 1 Timothy chapter 4. And we're reading from verse 8. In verse 8, it says, for bodily exercise profiteth little. Bodily exercise profiteth little. Then it goes on to say in that verse 8, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having the promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. You see what the Holy Ghost is telling us there? It says bodily exercise profiteth little. What it means is earthly gain profiteth little. What it means is human enterprise profiteth little. Why little? Well, think about it. whatever you have in this world, let's say, for example, you get educated, you have profession, you have this, you have that, and you have money, and you build this and build this. You have a house here in the big city, one big city in Nigeria. You have another house in UK. You have another house in Canada. Another house in America. Another house in Hong Kong. Another house in Japan. Another house somewhere over there. All that is Astley Enterprise. And all that, let's even say you enjoy that for 100 years. 100 years. To you, 100 years, that's long. And then you die. Because there is nobody that will come to this world that will not leave. Methuselah is gone. Everybody will go. I said everybody will go. So after 100 years, then you leave. If you get to heaven, and you will get to heaven. 100 years, you've just started. 1,000 years, you just started. 10,000 years, you've just started. 1,000,000 years, you've just started. 100 years on earth, whatever you enjoy there, 100 years, in comparison with 1,000,000 years, this one is little. 100 years, little. Out of when you go over there, 2,000,000 years, you're still there. And there's joy every day. No pain, no sickness, no infirmity, no sorrow, no disappointment. Over there for 3,000,000 years, 10,000,000 years, trillion years, forever and ever. All the Astley Enterprise here, whatever it means, whatever you gain, whatever you got, this one is little. I said this one is little. That's why it says bodily enterprise or bodily exercise or all the earthly gain and interest that profiteth little. Just a short time. But godliness is profitable. For the life that now is and for the life which is to come, I will concentrate on that. I said I will concentrate on that. I'm going to labor for the things that dwell and abide forever and ever. Look at Isaiah chapter 48. Profitable people. I said I'm talking to profitable people. Isaiah chapter 48. And I'm reading here from verse 17. Isaiah chapter 48. I'm reading from verse 17. Here is what it tells us in verse 17. It says, thus says the Lord, thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. And it says, I am the Lord thy God, which teaches thee to profit. I am the Lord your God, which teaches thee to profit. From today, all the wisdom you need to be profitable, the Lord will give you. The grace you need to be profitable, the Lord will give you. The energy, the strength you need to be profitable in this work of the Lord will give you. This work will prosper in your hand. It will not drop from your hand. You will not abandon the work. You will profit in this in Jesus' name. And it says, which leadeth thee in the way thou shouldest go. Thou hast hearkened to my commandment, then had thy peace been as a river, and thy righteousness as the waves of the sea. It will begin today. And then it says, and thy seed, even blessing, will come upon your family. And I seed also had been as the sand, and the offspring of thy bowels is like the gravel thereof. Then it says, and his name should not have been cut off nor destroyed from before me. Then it says, now go forth. If the Lord is promising all this, it says, go forth. You'll go forth. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. Son of man, I made you a watchman over the house of Israel. Hear the word at my mouth and tell them. If you tell them when you hear the word, those who hear and believe, they will be saved. If they don't hear, if they don't believe, you have rescued, you have delivered your own soul. Their blood will not be required at your hand. The Lord is coming. the day of reckoning is coming, and the day of inventory to say, what did you do? I gave you 5 talents. What did you do with those 5 talents? I gave you 2 talents. What did you do with those 2 talents? I gave you 1. What did you do? When that day comes, I pray you will not stammer. I pray you will not regret. I pray you will not be looking down and say, I wanted to, but I didn't actually get to the place I should be. Today, you are rising up to do the work of God. And when you start today, you'll never look back. You'll never stop. You'll keep on moving in the grace of God. And then in this world, the Lord will reward you. In the life to come, you will not lose your reward. I'll see a crown on your head. I will see stars in your crown. The joy of the Lord be forever and ever in your life in Jesus' name. Somebody wants to rise up and wants to pray. Wants to say, now is the time for me to go forth. And I'm going to go forth in the strength of the Lord. I'm going to work, and the Lord will prosper this work in my hand. The time has come for you to consider the work and to become fruitful. You will be fruitful. You will be fruitful. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer.